Hi, I'm Mayor Greg Fisher, and I would like to welcome you to the third segment of our new Metro TV series entitled Justice for All, Louisville's Criminal Justice System. It's our intent through this series to provide viewers and community residents with information about the operation of our local criminal justice system, and more specifically, to introduce the key players, the involved agencies, and their respective missions, and explain how the system operates, provide available data related to system cost and what research tells us is working, and also to discuss emerging trends, issues, and projects, and then talk about the role of the entire community. Now, historically, a lot of our efforts to educate the public about the criminal justice system have occurred on a reactive basis rather than a proactive basis, and they were focused only on selected programs and agencies rather than the entire system. Additionally, unless you have had a personal experience with the criminal justice system or knowledge gained maybe through a friend or a relative involved in the system, you may not fully understand how the entire justice process works. So I'm hopeful that this new initiative will help us reach a broader community-wide audience and provide timely and transparent information about local justice system policies and practices and enhance our efforts to recruit and bring new talent into justice and public safety agencies that reflect the entire makeup of our community. This segment focuses on women in justice and public safety and features the experiences and challenges faced by women who have pursued careers as police or correctional officers, dispatchers, firefighters, EMTs, or paramedics. You should know that my administration is committed to ensuring that our workforce mirrors the entire community population as a whole, and to increasing the number of women serving in these important positions. Following the presentation of each department, you will receive information on how to apply for a position or who to contact for more information if you or someone you know might be interested in learning more about serving your community as a justice or public safety professional. So I hope you enjoy the program, and thanks for watching.
Hello, I'm Lieutenant Andrea Brown with the Louisville Metro Police Department. Working in the field of law enforcement has provided me and countless other women with the opportunity to make a real difference in our community. Good police work relies on one of our greatest strengths, problem solving. From convincing teenagers not to text or drink while driving, to creating the best plan to shuttle hundreds of thousands of people in and out of the greatest 2 minutes in sports, the Kentucky Derby. And of course, we're working daily to outsmart the bad guys so that we can keep our community safe. For the last 15 years, I've done more than just put on the uniform every day. I've worked to advance my career from patrol officer to lieutenant, not only gaining more responsibility, but also mentoring other women who joined the department. Best of all, being a member of the Louisville Metro Police Department has given me a world of adventure right here in my own town. I hope you'll spend a few minutes hearing from some of our other officers, and you'll see why so many women have found such a rewarding career in law enforcement.
Hello, I'm Officer Eja Lockhart with the Louisville Metro Police Department. I've been on for approximately 16 years. I'm currently with the 8th Division, 2nd Platoon, which is day work, on patrol. Some of the challenges that I have experienced on the police department has been few. Primarily dealing with some of the public, particularly larger men, feeling like that they can overpower you. I've been fortunate enough and with proper training have been able to manipulate the situation to my betterment just through communication. Being able to communicate effectively has allowed me a very healthy career. Some of the barriers that I've had basically I think is just the physicality of things. We're demanded to do everything that our male counterparts do, and you know, going through the academy, there was definitely some physical challenges there, and to stay healthy and fit, you know, throughout your career has definitely been a barrier. especially for a woman when you, as you age, it can be more challenging. So the rewards I've found being with Louisville Metro Police Department has definitely been the needle in the haystack. When you least expect it, someone comes up to you and shows their appreciation for even locking them up. You know, it's been very tender, or being hugged by someone that appreciates something that you were able to do for their family, down to domestic violence. You know, a person that's, you know, had a drinking problem, and then you get to see them on the street because you were able to take them to the healing place, and they're doing much, much better. Those are the rewards. And when you do this job, you can't wait for those. They don't come as often as I would prefer, but I'm grateful when they do. For a woman that is looking to come to Louisville Metro Police Department as a career, the very first thing that I would say is to look inside yourself. You're going to see members of your family on the street, and if you're going to have moments of great compassion, and if you don't, then this may not be the job for you. I say prepare yourself physically. It's very necessary. And be prepared to see some disheartening things, because we encounter all of those, good and bad.
I'm Detective Shannon Rexius, a proud member of the Louisville Metro Police Department. Unlike a lot of people, I don't have any family or friends in law enforcement, so it's not like I was born and bred to do this profession. In fact, while I was majoring in Justice Administration at the University of Louisville, I was still uncertain exactly what I wanted to do as a career. A short time later, the Louisville Metro Police Department experienced one of the worst tragedies in its existence. Officer Peter Grignon was shot and killed while in the line of duty. I remember watching the news coverage of the incident and the funeral. I was amazed to see the department and the community come together in a way that I'd never seen before. This was the first time I was able to witness the honor, dignity, and the courage displayed by all of our city's officers. I witnessed the brotherhood that I wanted to be part of. That's when I decided to apply to become a police officer. On February 13th, 2006, I joined the Metro Academy Class 9 as a member of the recruit class. Looking back, I can now see this is one of the best decisions I've ever made. Once you get on, the longer you have on, it's just kind of one of those, you just kind of fight through it. I know I deserve to be here. I know I've done the same training and worked just as hard as the guy next to me. So I think I go to bed and sleep at night just knowing that. Again, I just think the longer that you have on, it kind of, that just goes away. Hearing, you know, I get nervous at firearms. It's just one of the things. I'd never shot a gun until the first day of the academy. It was just not, I'm not a firearms person, but I had that mental block. I was nervous about it. Not coming from that background, it made me nervous. And to hear, the longer you're on, you hear guys that were nervous too, or guys that didn't pass the first time too, or guys that actually had to pay attention in training, just like I did. So that makes you feel a little better. Nobody wants, you know, everybody wants to be the bad guy and, you know, do a good job and all that. So I think that just knowing I was just like everybody else, you stand out in your own way, but also you're just one of the guys, for lack of a better term, I guess. That made me feel good. It makes me feel more comfortable in the job that I do every day. My time on the department has been well spent. I've learned a lot, and I think that you kind of just learn how to show that, and you don't have that boundary really you set for yourself as being a female. I think you have to overcome that yourself, because it's not how we used to hear that it was. So it does make it a little bit easier, and it does get easier the longer that you're on. What I find rewarding about this job is doing good work for good people. I try to do the best job that I can every day for the true victims that I have to work cases for. I think what I would tell somebody that is applying for the department would be, if it's what you want to do, I think we all know that we were called to do this. I didn't think I was born and raised to do this job, but it is absolutely what I was meant to do. I think that's never going to go away. If you know this is what you want to do, this is what you're supposed to do, do it. It's so fun. It really is the best job. You can do what you want when you want. You do good work. It's very rewarding. And the people that I've met on the department, they are really my brothers and sisters. I love every single one of them. We fight like brothers and sisters too at times. So we all have those, you know, crazy siblings. But it absolutely is a family. The family that I wanted, that I thought I was getting when I applied, is absolutely what I've gained by being in this profession.
Hi, I'm Sergeant Emily McKinley. I'm a sergeant in LMPD's homicide unit. I began my police career about 8 years ago. I was born and raised here in Louisville. I graduated from Seneca High School, went on to the University of Kentucky. I majored in biology. I have a biology degree from UK. After I graduated, I worked for about a year in their pharmacology department at their medical school. Didn't really enjoy what I was doing, didn't have a passion for what I was doing. Started to explore different career options. Led me to looking at the police department. And I went on a ride along with an officer. Really enjoyed it, thought it was really interesting. Started to apply. And went through the application process. It was about 4 or 5 months. Got into the police academy. Went through the police academy for another 8 months and graduated as an officer. And I began my career as an officer in the 2nd Division, patrolling the streets. As far as barriers that I've faced as a woman, as a police officer, obviously women aren't as physically large as men. And there have been times where you're dealing with people on the streets who are, quite a bit larger than you or stronger than you, and you have to take control of the situation. And, you know, through our training, we've learned how to diffuse a situation, you know, by speaking to someone and calmly speaking to someone, getting them to calm down instead of using any sort of physical confrontation like that. I guess that's some of the barriers that I've faced as a woman. As far as professionally, there's not a lot of women on the police department compared to men, and just proving yourself, you know, getting people to realize that you can do the job and you can do it well, and having the confidence to do that. So, go on a ride-along, talk to as many officers as you can, go on multiple ride-alongs, because you might go on one and, you know, it's kind of a dull night or there's not a whole lot going on, so you don't get the full perspective of the job. So go on a couple ride-alongs, talk to officers. It's not for everybody, and not everybody can do the job. There's things that you will see and hear and have to do that not everybody can do, and not everybody can handle that mentally or physically. So it's not for everybody. Go out there and talk to people. Go on those ride-alongs and see if it's something that you would be interested in. Then go through the academy and see what you think. The rewarding things that I have found in this career are just being able to help people. I know it sounds cliche, but, you know, helping people, getting involved in the community. You have an ownership in the community that you are living in and you're working in. So that has been rewarding. Being in homicide, I think it's very honorable to be able to solve the death of another human being, or, you know, figure out what happened in the last moments of another human being. And being able to share that with the family and providing them with some sort of closure and answers has been rewarding from the perspective of being in homicide.
Well, I think you get the picture. Coming to work with the Louisville Metro Police Department is not your routine 9-to-5 office job. Every day is a new opportunity for unlimited professional and personal growth. If you're the type of person where respect, honor, and dignity are more than just words, but an actual way of life, then I encourage you to contact the Louisville Metro Police Department for your chance at making a difference.
LMPD has an open and continuous application process. Requirements include the following. You must be a citizen at least 21 years of age with no felony convictions. Be a high school graduate or have earned a GED with at least one of the following. 60 college semester hours. Active duty military service, 4 years in the National Guard or Reserve, or employment as a full-time sworn officer in the United States within the last 12 months with at least 1 year of experience.
The Louisville Division of Fire, which started as the Louisville Fire Department, is a bucket brigade in 1780. It then progressed to numerous volunteer fire companies throughout the city in the early 1800s, and in 1858, the Louisville Fire Department became the second oldest fully paid fire department in the nation. The division currently has about 500 personnel that respond to over 33,000 calls per year. Overall, the fire service in the United States is a predominantly male culture and male occupation due to the fact that it's very physically demanding job. And so female firefighters coming into that culture has been a major change over the last 30 to 40 years. 30 years ago, 1984, we hired the first three female candidates in recruit class, a class that I too entered the department in. And a lot has changed in 30 years. And although we only have about 10 female firefighters as well as one female arson investigator, several of those are in leadership positions. And in our most recent recruit class, we actually had a female candidate that graduated with the gold badge, the top honor in the graduating class.
As a female, this job, you have to know it's a very physically demanding job.
This is a challenging job. It's challenging to get on, but it is not impossible.
Once I saw this position posted and applied for it, I knew that I definitely wanted it, so I put in a lot of time physically training so I could meet the requirements.
It's a long application process. There's going to be times where you feel like you're never going to get that email or that letter in the mail saying you've made it to the next step. But you just got to keep on striving, you got to keep learning, you got to keep working out, you got to keep exercising, keep a positive attitude.
If you're not lifting heavy weights, you need to be. There's not really any light tools on this job. You need to be running, you need to be just getting yourself in physical shape because this is very, very taxing work physically.
There's a lot of stereotypes. This is a man's profession. But women are fully capable of doing this job.
You know, a lot of females, most females typically don't have as much upper body strength as men do. And I'd always been in pretty good shape. I was an athlete in high school, and then as an adult, I always stayed active. But to be honest, it wasn't enough. And I had to really do some much heavier weight training than I'd ever done before to get ready for that physical test.
Physically, I was already in pretty good shape because I was playing rugby here in town. But I did increase the amount of steps that I was running. I added a backpack with some weights in it in order to simulate what it was going to feel like wearing our breathing apparatus that we wear on all of our incidences. And also I started concentrating on building muscles in my shoulders and in biceps and in core muscles in order to really get used to lifting the ladders and pulling the hoses that we have to do. And also just maintaining my cardiovascular fitness.
Well, to get the position, I had to do a lot of training, both physically and mentally. I had to review the material that they sent out to take for the written test, so that took a little bit of learning, a lot of chemistry and such. And then there was the physical portion, too, where you had to pass the POP standard, so I had to physically train for that, too. So those were some of the challenges that I had with that, as well as putting in the time and patience.
Then there's the mental aspect of things. If you can get your EMT certification before you come to drill school, that's going to help you out because you're going to have known the material already. And then it's going to make you a better EMT. The more you see it and the more you do it, you'll provide better service. Understand that you're a member of a team. You don't want to alienate yourself. In drill school, there were 3 females and 37 men. And my crew, for instance, I'm the only female. So you have to be able to work with anybody, but particularly you're going to be working with a group of guys. So just know that coming in, and it's fun, but just be ready. If you're not used to working with men, be ready for that. Mistakes, you're going to make mistakes. And they're probably going to mess with you and give you a hard time for making mistakes. But it's everybody makes them. It's how you recover. It's how you learn from it. So own up to your mistakes.
Both train mentally and physically. You know, we're not held to the same physical standards that the suppression side is. But we can still be digging out a scene for many hours and be on our feet for a lot. And, you know, there is a certain amount of physicality to it. So we might have to go hands-on with somebody that we're having to arrest. So it's really important to train physically. Definitely important to train mentally too. Arson, we see so many different types of fires, and it takes a good 5 years before you can actually feel confident on a fire scene because of all the different types of fires that we see. So I would recommend to start training, you know, train mentally in terms of fire science, maybe look up college programs on that, read material on that. And more than anything, you know, follow your heart's desire. If this is something that you want to do, if you don't pass the first time, you know, don't give up, keep following it.
And the most important bit of advice I'd give to anybody is be the hardest worker in the room. Understand that this job is time consuming. You have to be patient. The process is a long process. And you don't want to be the person that waits for someone else to do it for you. If there's a piece of trash, pick up the trash. If it needs to be mopped, mop it. So be a self-starter. And when everybody else wants to sit down and take it easy, you keep working. Once you do get the job and you go to drill school, then it's 6 months of 5 days a week, running, push-ups, getting yelled at, bear crawls, up and overs. It's a lot of physical work. And then you still have studying, you have tests you take almost every day. So you go home and you still have to study, and you got to test the next day, and you do it all over again for 6 months. So you're sore and you're tired, and there's a lot of time that goes into it. You've got to be patient. Your family has to be patient for that reason. It's a lot that goes into it. This profession is one where you are there to help other people, and they're typically strangers. You have no idea who they are. They're probably having the worst day of their life, and you're the one to show up to help them. So it could be a structure fire, it could be a car accident, it could be just a medical run, but yeah, understanding that these people are having a hard day, you treat them with compassion, with respect.
And trying to make it a little bit better for them, just letting them know that it's going to be all right, that we're here to help. Making a difference in somebody's lives is really a nice thing. If we make a medical run for an elderly person, just reassuring them that we're here and that they're going to be safe and that we'll get them to where they need to go. Or just something as simple as unlocking a car that mom has accidentally locked somebody in. Just reassuring that kid and the mom that things are okay, we're here to help, and we'll move on after that.
And then probably one of the most rewarding things too is getting to work with teenagers. We work with a lot of teenagers that get into fire setting behaviors, playing with fire, and it's a very critical time in their development that we can actually step in and help them out with the help that they need.
Before I became a firefighter, I was a school teacher, and I was used to giving of myself and helping other students, being part of a team. So that made the transition to firefighting a little easier.
I get a lot of things like, oh, can you carry a 250-pound man out of a fire? It's like, no, but I can drag him out. And that's why we work as a team, because we can all work together to get somebody out as needed. It's a team atmosphere, and you need to be able to work with a team in order to achieve any of the goals, from a medical run to a structure fire. We all have to work as a team. And if you're able to work, and it's male or female, as in a team atmosphere, then anybody is going to succeed in this job.
I know that I can always count on my coworkers to help me out on a scene. Even though we have lead investigator on a scene, it's considered a team approach. We all show up on the scene. We all divide the labors, whether it be digging out the scene, talking to witnesses, taking recorded statements, taking pictures. We divide that out. So one of the most rewarding things is definitely the team that I work with.
I get to work at a little bit before 7 every day. Shift changes at 8, but I get here, get my gear on track. I check all my pack and my T-Pass, and then I start checking the apparatus, make sure we've got water. I change out the water in the water cooler, check the radios, keys, make sure things are where they're supposed to be. As for daily routine, that all happens every day, no matter what. But what isn't routine is whatever kind of calls you get. It may come in the middle of dinner or while you're cooking.
Typical day would entail arriving at the firehouse in order to relieve the off-going platoon, and we get a rundown as to what the day before was about. And I can plan my day. If we have any trainings or community involvement that we need to attend to, we'll schedule that. We'll line out the shift as to who's riding where, get all my paperwork done. We'll try and get a schedule of workout in and any schooling that we need to do. And that's all in between making 7 to 8, maybe more runs throughout the day. And those runs could entail BLS runs, from a stubbed toe to a whole CPR incident with EMS. That would take several hours, or a car fire to a structure fire that were there 3 and 4 hours at a time.
Our first priority is responding to fire scenes. If we get requested by the incident commander to the fire scene, then we go out there, we investigate the fire, look at the scene, talk to witnesses, determine if it might be an accidental fire or if it was a set fire, and then follow up from there if it appears to be a set fire, to determine who set the fire, and if we do determine who set the fire, to do an arrest with that. So we also spend a lot of time in court as well, following up with that. But then also we'll have investigations that kind of pend for a while that we might not be able to know at the scene who set the fire, and we have to do a lot of follow-up work too. So that's part of an average day also.
We are a fire department that is very steeped in tradition, and we take pride in delivering excellent services to our community. The women and the men in this organization are what make it successful and make the Louisville Division of Fire one of the best fire departments in the nation.
I am Mark Bolton. I am director of the Louisville Metro Department of Corrections. And as director, I am responsible for the care, custody, and control of the inmate population in the Louisville metropolitan area. About 30% of our employee force at Metro Corrections are women employees. And they include individuals that are sworn corrections officers, records personnel, classification and counseling staff, as well as contract healthcare providers and contract food services and commissary providers. Women make up a unique part of Metro Corrections in that they do the same thing that male officers do. They're responsible for supervising inmates. They are responsible for searching housing units. They are responsible for cell entry and cell searches. Booking individuals as they're processed in through the system. So they play the same role that male officers do, and they provide an incredible public service within the Metro Corrections system.
The Louisville Metro Department of Corrections is made up of 3 facilities, which include the main jail complex on 6th and Liberty, the Hall of Justice on 6th and Jefferson, and the Community Corrections Center located on Chestnut Street. LMDC was previously called Jefferson County Corrections, but the name was changed in 2003 when city and county government merged. As of October 2014, Metro Corrections employed 560 individuals, comprising sworn corrections peace officers and non-sworn civilian staff. Of this, 157 employees were women. Historically, women working in corrections were only permitted to work in female detention facilities. However, they worked apart from residential units. It wasn't until even the late 80s that all states were found to be hiring female officers to work in male facilities. And in 2001, females made up nearly 25% of all correctional officers in male facilities. The number of women working in corrections is steadily increasing. According to the 2012 American Correctional Association's report on adult correctional personnel by gender and race, women made up 40% of adult correctional personnel.
Hi, my name's Elizabeth Coons. I graduated from Bellarmine University with a major in communications and a minor in writing. I've been with the LMDC department for about 9 months now. I had no previous law enforcement training whenever I went to school. What got me interested in the job was that my second cousin was the previous major, and it was a good job with great opportunities that I just thought that I'd try to do. As a corrections officer, I found that especially being female, there's a lot of obstacles and hurdles that you have to be able to overcome. One of which being that whenever you first start an academy, you don't really understand what you're getting yourself into. It's a male-dominated job, so whenever you come in here, it's definitely an eye-opener. I don't think that they expect you to be able to do the same things that they can do, whether it be a strength or size thing. And that's true to a degree, but I feel like as a woman, you actually have to work harder in order to prove yourself to your coworkers and the other officers that you work with. I think one of the other issues is that being that you are smaller, being a female, you have to be able to be cunning in other ways in order to get what you want, because whenever you work on a men's floor, there is a pretty big size difference with most of the inmates that you encounter. And I feel like being able to know how to talk to people is really important. Another issue, and it's not necessarily a good or bad thing, but this job changes you. No matter who you are, it really does. It changes you. And I think it's important to remember who you started out as and where you started from. So I think that LMDC has an amazing training program for the fact that you're always prepared for your worst day. So especially dealing with males in general, or just anybody, because you have women that can be just as dangerous as some of the men that come in here. So I think that's what they always told us in academy. You're getting prepared for your worst day. And luckily, I haven't seen it yet, but it's going to come one day. And I know that due to the training that I've gotten, I'm going to be ready for it. I would say that it's a great opportunity to push yourself to do things that you never thought you'd be able to do. I know that ever since I've started here, I've gained a lot of confidence. And I think that's really helped me kind of develop as a person, become more independent. There's a lot of opportunity to move up, whether eventually I want to take my degree and move up administratively, or if I want to stay on the security side of the jail and move up that way. And I think that there's a lot of opportunity, especially for women, to be able to do such.
My name is Mary Lee Nicholas Bates. I was at a point in my life where I was going to make a career change to try to give something back to the community. I applied at Louisville Metro Department of Corrections and was hired a short time thereafter. I started as an officer and worked the grill, which is where people come into the jail. After I worked there for about a year, the department was going to try to civilianize certain areas. And at that time, it actually was very good for me because my mother was critically ill. I took a short time off and came back and was civilian at that point and started with the Department of Records, which was a completely different animal. Very, very heavy, just a lot of work, a lot of work, very tedious work. It was a challenge and I loved it. I didn't realize that there would be an area for me to go if I gave up my badge, but in this case, it was a really nice change. I went to the Department of Records and decided I wanted to learn as much as I possibly could about the Department of Corrections and all the jobs that it had. I went from there, I went over to what was called intake and release, which is the identification section. Learned a great deal about fingerprinting and identification to do a positive ID through fingerprints. I went back to school about midlife, and I felt like it was one of the best things I ever did. If it wasn't for the Department of Corrections, I probably may not have done that, but I thought, what a challenge. I have three sons, a single mother, and I'm going back to school in my 40s. So I went back to school. I graduated with honors. Very happy. Me and my son actually graduated at the same time, and took a small trip, came back, and put in, you know, applications for promotions. At that point, I was able to promote to Correction Supervisor 1, which is the current position that I hold. I love the people that I work with. I've spent a great deal of time with them, and it's sometimes hard to separate the boundaries as far as being their supervisor, seeing how I've worked beside them for so many years. When I was an officer, some of the challenges that I faced, obviously, were having to, you know, take care, custody, and control over men. Being a female, sometimes men can be very aggressive, but I found that if you treat people with respect and treat them how you want to be treated yourself, most times if you just tell them what their options are, you can usually have them respond in a positive way. Just treating them fairly and being consistent and show that you're going to do what you say you're going to do. Keep your word and be honest, be fair. I definitely take the tour. It's an eye-opener in itself. They have an opportunity to come in and do different tasks. There's different types of positions here as far as the security side is concerned. There's also the breathalyzer out in the BA lab. There's working the grill. You can work up on the floors, HIP, CCC with work release programs. There's other things that go on in corrections other than just an inmate in a cell. We try to, you know, I don't want to necessarily say rehabilitate, but give inmates a positive future by allowing those options as far as having classes to get their GED, and try to direct them so that when they're ready to go back out into the community, that they will make a positive life for themselves. In corrections, I find that the most rewarding thing here for me is to meet so many different people, a different caliber of people, different backgrounds, different cultures. The one thing that is the most positive is that I find that we're all just one race of people. We are the human race, and we're out to be sure that we make the best of it here as far as, you know, making inmates be able to know that they can have a positive life after this. It isn't just the end of the world, that they can turn around. And corrections does, like I said, have a lot of programs to help them do just that. So that's been quite rewarding for me.
I've been at Metro Corrections now for 18 years. I started October the 11th of 1996. I actually showed up for the academy the first day and had no idea what I was starting in. The second day I left and went back to my other job and decided that I wanted to come back and have a career. So I came back and, you know, proved to them, showed them that this is really what I wanted to do, that I wanted to make it a career. So I stayed for the last 18 years. I was an officer for 7 years, and about 7.5 years I was an officer. I did numerous things, worked in security, I was a gym officer, I took all the inmates to gym. I became a sergeant in March of, I think, 2004, and I was a sergeant for about 3 years. Then I became lieutenant, and I was over at our community corrections facility, and that is where we do our work release. We have inmates there that are on work release, and, you know, we have them go out to work in the community and come back and return, and we house them over there. I now have been moved it's not exactly a promotion, but it's a different position that I'm now in professional standards unit. It's PSU, it's our internal affairs unit. And now I handle all administrative investigations with all of our staff. The challenges I've had that I've had to overcome were basically just being a female in law enforcement. I'm only 5'2" and a half, so it was very difficult when I first came in. It's very intimidating. I've never been yelled at, so it's different to have, when we were at the academy, have, you know, drill instructors yell at you, and then having inmates cuss and yell at you. So it's a very difficult position, but when you get here and you get through the academy, you realize, I mean, the women are the best here. You know, the women are, it's so much easier for women. So it's, I've overcome kind of the intimidation or the fear of being here and being, I don't know, I guess just being smaller, and kind of living a sheltered life. So now I'm here and it just, I'm able to, you know, when officers need use of force, I think a lot of times we can, you know, calm the situation down more, being female. A lot of times just women, you know, we speak to inmates, we mother them more, and so we can get a lot more accomplished. One of the positions I had here at Metro Corrections was being a female gym officer. That basically meant that daily, I would take inmates on a chain to gym, 400 plus inmates we would take on a regular basis every day to gym to exercise. And it's very intimidating putting 25 inmates on a chain and putting them on the elevator, you by yourself. But I've never had an incident. They always did exactly as they always complied. And that was very rewarding. It was a barrier that I had, but it was nice to, it was just nice that they always did what you said. Like I said, and if they would fight in the gym, I mean, it was no big thing. I would just run and pull them apart or tackle them, and they would always immediately stop. Miss Eubanks, are you okay? And that was, they really were concerned about us. But just, I think it's a great job. I think that, you can come in, you can get an education here, and you just really learn a lot. I think it's a great job. People always ask me, do you like it? And I always say, I love it. If I didn't like it, I wouldn't have been here for 18 years. I really do like it. I really do promote it. Law enforcement is a great field, and it's a wonderful field for females. The things that I've found rewarding about this position, I feel like I get paid a lot. We have great benefits. We have a lot of sick time, a lot of vacation time that you can still spend time with your family, but, get the job done. It's just, you're kind of a role model to a lot of people. And it's great to walk in the community and people see you, especially little kids, and they always look up to you. And it's really nice to be a female, to be a mother, and for little, kids to see you and think, gosh, that's, that could be my mom. So it's really cool to be a role model in the community and let people see you and see you in your uniform.
I am Major Endora Davis. I've been with the department since 1996. Since I've been here at Corrections, I've had the opportunity to further my education. I've received associates, a bachelor's, and recently a master's degree, which has helped me with the tuition reimbursement provided by Metro government. Starting here in 1996, and then 2004, I took the sergeant promotional exam, and I was promoted in May of 2004. From that point, I took the lieutenant's promotional exam, and I was promoted in May of 2007. And just recently, I was newly appointed the major of Metro Corrections, and I am the second African-American female to hold this position. And I am the only major who currently has a master's degree. When I started my career here at Metro Corrections, it was actually Jefferson County Corrections. We had two buildings at that time. We had the Hall of Justice and we had CCC. So we had half the inmates that we have now. When I used to come to work daily, I didn't know what was going to happen. We had a different culture of inmates back then. They were very aggressive. I had the opportunity to join our CERT team, which was then Corrections Emergency Response Team. Now it's a SORT team, but I was able to learn special skills, tactics, pressure points in case I was into any type of situation to where I had to be able to get myself out of from an overpowering inmate. I learned the different challenges of having to communicate with the different agencies and the different departments, knowing that security is not the only thing that makes corrections work. There's so many different outlets. There's so many different contracted companies that you have to work with. And if all of those departments don't work together, you won't have a smooth run department. So I've really learned a lot as an administrative lieutenant. It's rewarding to be able to advance. It's rewarding to be able to learn. You working here at Corrections, you have the opportunity to show that you are capable of doing things that you didn't know that you were capable of doing. Either be with your mind or physical or just communicating with coworkers. This is a melting pot here. You have so many different cultures that come in, so many different lifestyles. You have to learn to work with them. So you get challenged, but it's rewarding on the flip side of it, knowing that you will be able to communicate with other people that have grown up with different values that you have had when you were growing up. In the academy, they teach us IPC skills, and it helps us communicate with the inmates. And it's very important that you learn how to communicate with the inmates, because we're not here to judge people for whatever crime that they are accused of. We're just here to maintain and make sure that they're being taken care of before they're pre-sentencing. I would tell young ladies that this is a very rewarding career. It's not a job, it is a career. Somewhere that you can come to, somewhere that you can retire from, you can learn, you can advance, you meet different people. I always said nobody wakes up saying, I want to be a correction officer. They may say they want to be a police officer when they grow up, but you hardly hear correction officer. But actually coming into this field and learning that you do have avenues and that you are important and that you can make a difference in people's lives, because there's a lot of inmates in this facility that don't have guidance. So if you take the time to instruct these inmates and to be there for them in a professional way, you'll have the opportunity to affect their lives. So it's very rewarding, not just as an officer, but just being able to change a life. You can do that.
If you are interested in a career with the Louisville Metro Department of Corrections, please visit our website, accessible through www.louisvilleky.gov, and click on the Corrections tab. We would also like you to join us on Facebook to learn more about our department and give us a like. We would appreciate that.
If you're seeking a fast-paced, exciting career that puts your skills and knowledge to work and lets you give back to your community, Emergency Medical Services is right for you. Louisville Metro EMS provides around-the-clock 911 emergency medical care to patients all across the city. We believe in patient care that's evidence-based and medically focused, and LMEMS has been recognized as a national leader in the field for our cutting-edge approach to out-of-hospital care. LMEMS strives to build a workforce that reflects the community it serves. More than a quarter of our EMTs and paramedics are female, serving in a variety of capacities throughout the organization. These are just a few of the women who are leaders at Louisville Metro EMS. Major Jenny Cravens is a paramedic and operations officer who works in our Quality Assurance Division.
I started out as an EMT, then moved up to a paramedic. I was actually a paramedic graduate, so I was finishing up paramedic school when I started here. So I was an EMT for a little while, and then I became a paramedic, and then I moved up to a major, which is a supervisor operations officer. with Metro EMS, and now I do quality assurance. So I'm kind of responsible for making sure that everybody is providing proper medical care, developing new protocols, kind of guiding the medical, the way that the medicine goes in the service. The way I got into this is I've always kind of been like a really sciencey, nerdy person. You know, I loved biology and everything in school. I actually have a biology degree from U of L, and I grew up watching, you know, Rescue 911, and every time there was an ambulance driving by, for some reason it was like I was drawn to it. And so when I got into college, I was pre-med, and I went into an EMT class just to get into something medical in the meantime. And once I got into that, I just kind of fell in love with it. And because of training that we've been given, I was able to overcome a lot of the barriers. You know, when I first started here, my preceptor that trained me, you know, showed me how to lift the stretcher, where to lift on the stretcher. There's like a higher bar and a lower bar. So if you're a shorter person, you use the lower bar. It's a little easier for you to lift. And then when I first started, I was more timid than I am now. I didn't really like confrontation or kind of stepping out of my comfort zone and using my big girl voice, as we call it. So I had to learn to stand up for myself and be aggressive and assertive. And once I got that down, you know, people not taking me as seriously kind of went away, because they realized, oh, she is in charge and she does know what's going on. And, you know, being the female paramedic on the truck, you're kind of in charge of patient care on scene because you're the highest medical authority in the truck. So even when I had a male partner, I had to step up, you know, and be more aggressive than they were, because I was the one who was in charge. And so once I learned to do that, it made things much smoother. I think the most rewarding parts of this career are getting to help people. You know, you're with people during a very stressful and scary time in their life, even if it's not what you would consider an emergency for that person. You know, it's one of the worst days that they're going through, and to be a positive influence on that day for them, and in the end have, you know, them thank you, or to be the reason that their family member survived whatever ordeal they were going through, it's really rewarding to know that you played a part in that. You know, we're there to deliver babies, we're there to deliver bad news to parents about their children if they don't survive something, and just being able to do that with compassion and make a difference in that family's life is really rewarding. So one of the, I guess, other unique things with my situation is my husband works for Louisville Metro EMS also. We met in EMS, and, you know, we've been together ever since, and so we both go through the same types of things, which sometimes is good and sometimes is bad. You know, it's a lot of people who are in public safety but are married to somebody who's not. It's hard when you go home and you've got, you know, the weight of your job weighing on you to be able to communicate that to your spouse, because when you're not in public safety, you just don't understand. As much as you try to, it's hard, you know, to understand what we're going through if we've had a really bad run. And so the good thing with being married to somebody else in public safety is when I go home, he doesn't have to, you know, I don't even have to tell him, he understands right away. I think it's important before you get into a job in EMS to really understand what we do. I think a lot of times coming into this, you think it's, you know, like the TV shows, and it's a lot of, you make really cool accidents and you run a lot and you save lives, and there's a lot more to it than that. You know, the true life-saving emergencies are a small amount of what we do. A lot of what we do is just taking care of people, you know, when they're not necessarily having that huge emergency, but they just need somebody, or they need, you know, a ride to the hospital. And I think you have to be able to have empathy for them and understand that while it's not what you would consider using 911 for, that they, you know, feel like it is, and that's a big deal to them, and you have to be able to be sympathetic to that and have patience with them, even when it's something that you think is silly.
Major Aaron Winters is a paramedic and operations officer for LMEMS.
I think the biggest thing for me, the biggest reason I do this job is it's a way of life. You really, there's a lot of hours, there's a lot of time commitment, a lot that goes into it, but we really are, truly are a family. So, you know, if you're looking for a job like that, that's the greatest thing about this job. You'll always have people there, you know, always people to have your back no matter what your situation is going on, you know, always somebody to help you out. I got into it, I was actually looking for last five elective hours to get my college degree. I needed 5 hours. I'd studied sports medicine. I really honestly just thought the EMT class would be easy. And it was, but it was that whole family part of it and that whole community is what I fell in love with, so I stayed, you know. Physical limitations wise, I guess the biggest thing for me is being shorter. To lift the stretcher is sometimes a bigger deal for us because the head of it, you have to lift a lot higher. The guys are generally bigger in stature, have an easier time doing that. It's important that you try and get a partner that's roughly the same size you are. It makes your life a lot easier, and that's harder to do when there's, you know, just a few women, mostly men. Some of the barriers that I've encountered, I think you just maybe have to work a little harder than the guys do to prove yourself. You know, they might be a little harder on you initially to prove that you know how to do your job. But once you do that, I haven't really had many problems. It's just that initial proof of yourself. I think the most rewarding thing is you know, when you truly do help somebody and you see, you get that thanks from the family. You know, it's a pretty thankless job. You know, you always have people angry with you. You always have, you know, people that want to abuse the system. But when you do have those families that come back and say, hey, you know, you really helped and my family member is still there because of what you guys did for them, that's the rewarding part.
Amanda Potter is an emergency medical technician who joined the team at LMEMS in 2012.
Right now, my status is an EMT. I started doing this because I've had a knack for medical knowledge and I also like to help people. I found a lot of times I like to help people more so than I help myself, so I figure I put it to good use to do it as an EMT. Well, I got interested in this field because I took a class in college, a first aid class. And I think I did it just as an extracurricular, but I actually found that I really enjoy learning about how my body works and why my body reacts to certain illnesses or doesn't react to certain illnesses. And my dad's also a physical therapist too, so I ran with that, and that's how I ended up. Not everybody's gonna like me. Some people don't like EMS, but I mean, I still have a job that I have to do, and I mean, if I'm called out to a location for a certain medical condition, then I do what I have to do. Sometimes I think people realize just how bad they're treating us, and at the end of the day, they apologize and everything smooths out in the end. So I really don't worry about it. I just do what I have to do. One of the biggest challenges that I have found as a woman is still not being treated as an equal by some of our patients. They still think that a woman has a certain role in a certain place, and so when we make runs, some of them, they don't respect us, or they try to push the limits to see what they can get away with us. The most, like I said, the most rewarding thing in the beginning that I said was just the fact that I get to help people that may not be able to help themselves or that can't. It's a thankless job, so I enjoy that. I didn't think I would get as emotionally involved. I mean, you have to keep your emotions in check while you're on the run, but there have been some runs that have bothered me and got to me, but I've had a lot of people tell me that if you don't have emotion, then you're in the wrong line of work.
If you're interested in a career in EMS, we'd love to talk to you. You can contact us at 574-4260 or go to our website, www.louisvilleky.gov/EMS.
All of the public safety departments that you just learned about would not operate efficiently if it wasn't for the staff at MetroSafe's 911 call center, where over 80% of the staff are women. Let's find out more about their history and what it's like to be part of MetroSafe from a few of the women who made the call center their career.
Hi, I'm Jody Duncan. I'm the Public Information Officer for Emergency Management Agency MetroSafe. MetroSafe takes all the 911 calls in the city, but it used to not be like that. Before merger happened of Louisville and Jefferson County, we had five different locations that took the 911 calls. And because of that, things weren't as efficient as they could be. So what we did is we got everybody together, the police department, the fire department, and the ambulance service. All of those merged together in our communications center, and now we have a one-stop shop. So when you call 911, and by the way, we did take 1.4 million calls last year, and those did include 911 calls as well as administrative calls, or non-emergency calls, if you will. Anyhow, when you call 911, you get a call taker, and that call taker will most certainly give you the information that you need or send you out the appropriate unit to respond, whether it be fire department or the police department or an ambulance. Once they get all of the information that they need, which is very minimal actually, your name, address, and phone number, and what's going on, they'll send the information over to a dispatcher, and that dispatcher will send it out to the appropriate entity, whether it be police, fire, or EMS. People do get frustrated. So, you know, all of our call takers are very versed in crisis, and they know how to get information from people. You know, they're information gatherers, and it's a wonderful, wonderful career to have. You know, I've never called this my job. I've always called it a career because it's something that a lot of people stick with for a long period of time.
Hello, my name is LaRonda Civils. I work for MetroSafe 911. I've been here 23 years. I started out as a recruit for the police department, and along the way I found that it wasn't for me, so I decided to look further into the law enforcement and decided this is what I wanted to do. As a woman, one of the challenges with this job, I haven't really decided that there are any challenges. I feel like that it is an advantage as a woman. But through it all, I haven't been able always to spend a lot of time with my family. But when I do, it's treasured and it's precious. But if I did not have this job financially, you know, maybe we wouldn't be able to do the things that we do, vacations, outings, you know, family time altogether. Yeah, there are its disadvantages. When it's all said at the end of the day, there's a lot more advantages when working here. They don't like the fact that I am homeless, but they do love the fact that I come home and tell them different stories or the advantages. I tell them about different things that go on during my day, and it lets them know that there are rewards for what I do. You know, maybe a life that I've saved. You know, sometimes I go home frustrated because there might have been a situation where it wasn't meant to be. But when it's all said, there are hugs and, you know, good job told to me when I get home at night. A lot of people may feel like that there are no rewards with this job, but in my case, I've had some very rewarding opportunities and experiences. One of those I can tell you about is I took a phone call one day on a drowning of a less than 1-year-old child.
Is he breathing?
No, ma'am. Okay. No, ma'am.
How old is he?
Oh, my goodness. He's a baby. He's 1 year old.
Okay. He is unconscious, right?
Yes, ma'am. He's unconscious.
But can someone do CPR?
Yes, ma'am. Somebody's trying to do CPR.
Okay. They're already doing it?
Yes, ma'am. It's a little fish pond, you know, things that people put in the ground for fish.
What's the baby doing now? Still not breathing?
The baby's out. Yes, ma'am. Still not breathing.
Do you know how long he's been there?
Yes. I don't know what happened.
I was to blow 2 breaths of air into the lungs.
Trying to blow 2 breaths of air into his lungs, blow it over his nose and his mouth.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Pump his chest 30 times. 2 to every 30.
2 to every 30. 2 breaths every 30 times.
Okay.
Did the cops call CPR?
Yeah, they're coming too. They're coming too. Are they still walking in?
Yeah. Keep doing it. Y'all keep doing it.
What you doing now?
We're still doing the same thing as the cop here.
Okay.
They said he's trying to, he just took a breath. I think he's taking one breath every few minutes.
Okay.
And I had left work not knowing the outcome, but only within days or so, I got a phone call. And lo and behold, the child survived. I actually got to meet that child, actually got to see his first birthday party, got to meet his parents. When you talk about rewards, that is one of the rewards that you get. Maybe sometimes there isn't closure. But on the other hand, this is one prime example that my job is rewarding. You may not think so, but to me, just the fact of feeling it in my insides and from my heart that I saved one means a blessing to me and a reward.
When I first started, well, you have to remember when I started, because I started back in 1981, because I graduated from Eastern Kentucky University in 1980. And so, you know, I wanted to be a police officer. That's all I ever wanted to do. I got a degree in criminal justice from Eastern Kentucky, came home, took the test. They had a vision requirement, so I couldn't make the vision requirement back then. My heart was broken, and so my dad, who was a homicide detective for the police department, said, why don't you try to be a dispatcher? So that's what I did. I became a dispatcher in 1981, and they put me on light watch, and I was the only female on light watch with all these guys. We worked for sworn police officers. So we were civilians in this little bitty place, 600 West Jefferson, cramped in there, with a bunch of males. And I was the only female, but we had a good time. But it was difficult. It was difficult at best because I was young and I was a female. And it was a police department. I mean, for goodness sakes, you know, it's the police department. It's not the 911 center back then, because we worked under the auspices of the police department. And so it was difficult. And we were, back then, being a 911 call taker or a dispatcher was a job. It wasn't a career. And we even went so far as to convince ourselves that we were just dispatchers. Because people would say, ask what you did, and you would say, I work for the police department. And they'd say, oh, are you a police officer? And you'd say, no, I'm just a dispatcher. And so we, you know, even made ourselves feel kind of small because we would say, no, I'm not a police officer, I'm just a dispatcher. But nowadays, we're just a first responder, so it's much different today than it was then. Big barrier, obviously, is being a woman, and at that time, a young woman, and working with all males, and they thought that you were a female, so you, when you're female, you know, you're not that strong, so you're not able to, sometimes people always make the mistake of thinking that your kindness is a weakness, and that's not always the truth, so they would say, oh, you know, she can't do that because, you know, she's the girl, and I don't think that they meant it mean-spirited. I think that they just meant, or that they thought that because you're a woman, that you were soft and that you weren't going to stand strong and that you weren't going to take control of a call or take control of a radio channel. I think that's probably what they thought. It wasn't a mean-spirited kind of thing, but yeah, that was a challenge, as being the only woman on the late watch. Working for EMA MetroSafe, specifically being a call taker or dispatcher in the 911 Communications Center or 311 or any of the positions that we have in our agency, is probably the best job I've ever had and the hardest job I've ever had. Best job because it's been the most rewarding. It doesn't get any better than that to help people. The difficult part about that is that you don't always get to see those 911 calls or dispatch. You don't get to have the closure. Like if you're a first responder, you're a police officer, you get to respond and you get to take care of the situation and you get to have some closure. In other words, you clear from that call for service and you walk away knowing that you did a good job or that, you know, you did what you intended to do. But as a call taker or a dispatcher, you know, you hang up that phone or in that radio transmission and you go on to the next one. So you don't really know what happens after you take that call and you send the responders out, there's no closure. So that makes it very, very difficult. Working, I think, nights and weekends and holidays, that's difficult. Being a parent or being a being a mom, having that balance is difficult. And I think as women, you know, we probably put more We probably put more pressure on ourselves to perform than I think our male counterparts do. So to have professionals on the other end that support that, and again, from the entry of the 911 call to the dispatch of the first responders, to the folks that take the 311 call, to the folks that work on our radio system, that do our NCIC, that, you know, all of those components, all those people support getting that 911 call to the correct safety responder to have a positive outcome. I mean, that's what they do to manage those resources for the city. So it's incredible. I mean, it's just incredible what they do each and every day. For my job as a director of our agency is helping people that come in and they become professionals. You know, they, again, you come in sometimes thinking, well, I'm just a call taker or just a dispatcher. And you watch them come in and excel at their career. They become excellent dispatchers, excellent call takers. You listen to them take a call for service and you can feel the passion. You can feel the confidence, the professionalism that they portray over the phone or over the radio or over a 311 call for that matter, or fixing some, you know, radio system, radio resource that we have. Regardless, anybody that comes in our agency, it's really a great reward to see them become professionals, to see them become successful, and to have that balance between work and their home life. It's very rewarding. It doesn't get any better than this. This is the best job ever.
I also wanted to give you a little bit of information on how to see if we are hiring or you want to be interested in knowing what we do and how we do it and what kind of qualifications that you do have for the call takers and the dispatchers here at MetroSafe, where we do take all the 911 calls. You would just go to www.louisvilleky.gov/jobs, and then you will look up a communication specialist one or two, and that would be the easiest way to do it. Now, if for some reason we're not hiring when you look that up, you can request that you get a postcard in the mail when we do have those offerings up. So again, that's www.louisvilleky.gov/jobs. And if you do need any additional information, or if you would love to take a tour of our facility, you can contact me, Jody, Jody.Duncan, Duncan, Duncan, at louisvilleky.gov.